Om je even op de HiFi Group. Welcome you in this second online seminar called Optimizing Growth. First, I shall introduce myself. My name is Ronald Valken. I'm product manager for HiFi Northwest Europe. And today we broadcast live from the studio in Amsterdam. Well, to explain to people who didn't visit the first webinar how this webinar is working, shall I explain how it's done. We have a moderating team. There are moderators available in Essen, Germany, live from the EPM, in Israel, in South Africa, and also in Holland. And this moderating team is ready to answer your questions. So if you have a question, you can go to the bottom right corner. There you have a chat box. And if you key in a question in this chat box, via the chat box, you get answers on your questions. And if the question pops up several times from different people, then the moderating team can put this question to the studio and we shall answer the question live here in the studio. Another thing that we are going to do today is polls, and that's to know who is our audience. And to show you what a poll is, I shall start a poll. And the poll I start is, what is your main type of crop? Do you have vegetables, cut flowers, pot plants, nursery stocks, or others? And you can just click on A, B, C, D, E. So don't put it in the message box, but just click A, B, C, D, and E. And I see that already a lot of people are responding. On top now it's vegetables. We wait a little bit longer. See what is coming in. Figures are still changing, but the vegetables are still the biggest group. Okay, 5 seconds, 4, 3, 2, 1, and the last one. And I shall directly show you the results. 60% of our audience is growing vegetables, 7% is growing cut flowers, 12% is growing pot plants, 7% are nursery stock, and 40% are others, and of course that can be everything. Hide the results. Okay, before we start this second webinar, I have to explain you, I shall give you the highlights from my first webinar. We saw that on social media, there were a lot of discussions about blossom end rot. In the first webinar, we explained that calcium is very important to avoid blossom end rot. So if you can get more calcium in your plants, you have less blossom end rot. If you want to know more about it, you can also go to our YouTube channel and there you can watch the video from the first webinar again. And another highlight is that also botrytis, if you have problems with botrytis, take care of your calcium uptake, because how more calcium you have in your plants, how better the uptake, of how better you can avoid botrytis. These are the main topics on social media after our first webinar. We invite you to give comments also via social media to us. And now I want to give over the microphone to Leo Marcelis, who is again in the studio. Leo, welcome.
Hey, thank you, Ronald.
Well, I want to give the microphone to you to start your lecture, and good luck.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, today I would like to talk about anion nutrition and how to optimize growth. So as indicated, my name is Leo Marcelis. I'm a professor in horticulture and product physiology at Wageningen University in the Netherlands. I'm head of a group who's doing research and education on the physiology, growth, development, and quality of horticultural plants, both during cultivation as well as post-harvest, or so after the products are harvested. The presentation of today I prepared together with my colleague Wim Voogd, who's working at Wageningen UR Greenhouse Horticulture. And Wim is already doing for more than 30 years research on plant nutrition. So what is the content of my presentation today? Well, we will talk about the anions, and the major anions are the nitrate, phosphate, and sulfate. So that will be the three topics I would like to address today. And then at the end of the presentation, I will come back with a few conclusions. So let's go on to the first topic, the nitrate. So growth in relation to nitrate NO3. So let's first look what are the major functions of nitrogen in the plant. I would say nitrogen, well, that's definitely the most essential element for a plant. You will find it in high concentrations. Usually about 3 to 5% of the dry mass is nitrogen. Well, where is it then? It's in enzymes. For instance, in the Rubisco enzyme, which is the major enzyme in plants and which is very important in photosynthesis. It's in DNA, in the genetic material of the plant. It's in the chlorophyll that makes the plant green. It has also a role in osmotic activity to keep the water in the plant, or also important for water uptake. Well, and the uptake of nitrogen, that's really an active process. It's regulated by the plant. As long as that there is some nitrate at the root surface, the uptake is regulated by the plant. And with the root surface, I really mean at the root itself. And if you now look at the graph on your screen, you see, for instance, the nitrate concentration on the y-axis and how far it is from the real root itself. So it can be in the rock wool, in the rooting medium, or in the soil. And then, for instance, in the bulk solution, the concentration can be 10 micromoles per liter. Well, and if you go then closer to the roots, then you will see close to the roots, the concentration can often be much lower, because at the root surface, the plants take up the nitrate, there the concentration drops. But as long as there is some nitrate at the root, then the uptake is mainly regulated by the plant. The plant determines whether or not he will take up that nitrate as it is available. So, and that makes then, in fact, that the uptake is more regulated. If it's regulated by the plant, it very much depends on the growth of the plant. The growth is determined by the conditions above ground, so the climatic conditions. But it also depends on the optimal concentration, or maybe I should better say the desired concentration of the plant. And if it is the desired concentration of the plant, we should go a little bit further and look at the concentration of the different organs of a plant. And that you can see here in this graph. What you see on the y-axis, it is a nitrogen concentration in the plant organ. And on the x-axis, you see the time in days after planting. This is an example from tomato. Well, if you first look at the green line, so the upper line, this green, that is for the leaves. You see initially, the concentration is relatively high, and then it goes down a little bit. Well, that's what you typically see in young plants or young organs. Usually they have a higher concentration, and then the concentration drops a little bit as the organs get older. But there's also a difference between organs. So you see the leaves on the top, the highest concentration. If you go to the yellow line, that's the lowest line. Well, you see the same pattern, initially a decrease. So this is the stem, which has a lower nitrogen concentration than the leaves. Well, the red line, that's for the fruits of a tomato plant, they are a bit in between. And then I also indicated the blue line, which is then the average for the plant as a whole. In our research, we do a lot of experiments on plant nutrition, but also we use simulation models. I will not tell today further anything about models, but just one calculation on how we, in a simulation model, can estimate or predict the uptake of nitrate under conditions that it is available. Well, where does it then depend on? We do then this calculation line, this equation, and don't be afraid, this is the only equation that I will use this evening. So we start with the C leaf. C stands for concentration, so the desired concentration of nitrogen in the leaf. We multiply that by the mass increase of the leaf. So that is the nitrogen needed for the leaf growth. Then we add to that what is needed for the stem. So that's C stem, concentration in the stem, multiplied by the mass increase of the stem. Well, then similarly, you have to add the fruits, the concentration in the fruits, multiplied by the mass increase of the fruits. And then finally, also the desired concentration in the roots, multiplied by its mass increase. Just to indicate how we could predict the nitrate uptake under conditions that the nitrate is available. Well, today I will talk about anions. So nitrate is an anion, nitrogen can also go to the plants as ammonium, but ammonium is a cation. So we'll not say much about it today, but it's good to realize that nitrogen can come as nitrate or as ammonium. And if there is some ammonium at the root surface, quite often the plants give priority to the uptake of ammonium. However, if you give too much ammonium for several plants, it's not that good always to give too much. Another aspect of nitrogen in the plant is that it is mobile. It can move in the plant. So it can, once it is in an old leaf, it can still has the possibility to move up in the plant to younger parts. Let's look at a few pictures what we do get if there is not sufficient nitrogen. Well, here you can see an example of a tomato. So what happens if there is not sufficient nitrogen? You get a reduction in growth. You get usually not so green color, less green color, or it can even get yellow. Yeah, and here you can see also the leaves are relatively small. Another crop, sweet pepper. At the left-hand side, you see a normal young sweet pepper plant, sufficient nitrogen. At the right-hand side, well, then that plant is definitely much smaller, so less nitrogen. And if you look a little bit more in detail, and I think you can see it here, is that also the leaves are not that green anymore. They get a bit yellow, and in particular, the lower leaves. Well, deficiency starts usually in older organs if the nutrient is mobile like nitrogen. So what do we see if there is some limitation? Then quite often nitrate, the nitrogen from the older leaves move to the younger leaves. And that's why then the older leaves get first yellow. Another crop, the poinsettia, well, very clear example at the right-hand side, plant with a sufficient nitrate supply at the left-hand side. Not sufficient. Well, I don't think that this will need any further explanation. Or here, the African violet at the right-hand side, plant well supplied with nitrogen, dark green leaves, and large plant. And at the left-hand side, much smaller plant, so growth is reduced quite a lot, and more or less yellow leaves. Before I tell a little bit more about some results from research about what nitrogen does do with a plant, I would like to ask you a question. So we will get a poll, and I will initiate this now. And the question I have for you is, which fertilizer is the most important for you? Is the most important for you potassium chloride, or is for you the most important potassium nitrate? Or maybe you don't use these fertilizers. So A, B, or C. A is the potassium chloride, B is the potassium nitrate, or C, you don't use it. And I see still quite some people are responding. So I wait a little while to give everybody the opportunity to react to this poll. And I guess we are more or less close that most people have responded. So then I will stop in a few seconds, 3, 2, 1, and then I stop. I will show you the results. You can see here that, well, it's very clear result that by far most of all the people are using potassium nitrate or as most important, and the potassium chloride is not so important. Well, why did I ask you this question? Because now I will continue about nitrate and also say some words about chloride. So for this, nice to compare it to that. So we'll now continue with my presentation. And what I want to show you now is an experiment that we did do with nitrate supply. It was an experiment with tomato on rock wool in a closed recirculation system. And we varied the nitrate supply from about, in the irrigation water, from about 4 to 8 millimolar. But I have to mention here one thing. If we vary the nitrate concentration, we also have to vary something else. That's the same as in my previous webinar about cations, where we indicated in a nutrient solution, if you change one ion, you always have to change one ion at least also. What did we choose in this experiment? We wanted to keep the EC constant such that we are not dealing with EC effects. Well, then if we reduced the nitrate supply, we supplied more chloride. Okay, let's now look in the graph. What do we see here? X-axis, the nitrate supply in the irrigation water. On the Y-axis, the production. And we use here the 100% for the high supply rate. Well, then you see, if you go down from a supply rate of about 8 millimolar to maybe 7 or maybe even a little bit lower, there was not much effect on production. But if you go down a little bit further, then you see that there is quite some reduction. So what you usually see, you can go down a little bit, usually not directly an effect, but if you go down a little bit further in the concentration, definitely growth reduction. Let's look a little bit more in detail on this experiment. And as we do here, now I added one line, the purple line, where you can see on the right-hand y-axis, that is the nitrogen concentration in the plant. And why do I present this? Because usually the concentration in the plant, that is what determines if there is an effect on the growth of a plant and how strong that effect is. Well, and what do we see here? That in fact, the curves for production and nitrogen in the plant were rather, were very much in parallel. So less nitrogen supply leads in the end to less nitrogen in the plant. And if there is less nitrogen in the plant, you will get a growth reduction. We can look a little bit further on this experiment, because you say, well, what did we vary? We varied the concentration of the irrigation water. But isn't it for the roots more important to look what the nitrogen is in the rooting medium? And the rooting medium in this case was rock wool. And that's what you see here. That's what you see in the red line indicated at the right-hand y-axis. Well, what can we learn from this graph? For instance, if the nitrogen supply in the irrigation water was about 7 millimolar, then we have also more or less 7 millimolar in the rooting medium. So that's where we have more or less an equilibrium. And that equilibrium we will only get if the concentration that the plants take up the nitrate is similar as in the irrigation water. So if the irrigation water was 7 millimolar per liter, in this experiment, the uptake of the plant was also at that concentration. Well, what happens then if we supply a little bit at higher rates? Well, then you see that the red curve goes up and the concentration in the rock wool increased quite a bit. On the other hand, if you go down the curve, lower supply rate, well, you get a quite a big decrease of the concentration in the rooting medium. Well, let's continue. The data that I have shown now can also be presented in a different way. And that we can see on the next slide. Yeah, you can see it here. What I plotted now on the x-axis is the nitrogen concentration in the rooting medium. And on the y-axis, you see the production. Well, what can you see here? That over a wide range, there is not any effect on production. Whether it ranges from 4 millimolars to up to over 20 millimolar, production is more or less similar. But once you go down at the lower values, well, then you get quite a dramatic effect on production. Okay, so this is about what the effects are of nitrate. But as I indicated, we did not only vary nitrate, because that would be impossible. We did do it here by replacing with chloride. So also the same data from the same experiment, I could also have shown you this graph. Same data on the y-axis, the production, but now plotted versus the chloride concentration in the rooting medium. Well, if I would have shown you this, then you would say, wow, at a high chloride concentration, I get a reduction in the production. Well, now you can debate, is this a chloride effect or is it a nitrate effect? Because at the highest chloride concentration, we had a very low nitrate concentration. Well, strictly speaking, from this experiment, you cannot conclude whether it's chloride or nitrate. But let's say, based on this experiment and many other experiments, I can be quite sure that the effects that we show here on production are the nitrate effects, and chloride had not really an effect on production this range. But what chloride had another quite interesting effect, and that is what you see here. So again, on the x-axis, the chloride concentration in the rooting medium, and on the y-axis, the calcium concentration in the fruit. And what do we see? The higher the chloride concentration, we get a slight increase in calcium concentration. And that we have seen in several experiments is that it seems that chloride enhances or facilitates the calcium transport in plants. At this moment, we do not fully understand the physiology behind it, but probably it has to do that the chloride and the calcium form an iron pair, which makes transport more easy. Well, if you have more calcium in the plant, that might be important for physiological disorders, as I've presented in my previous webinar. So calcium, if there's more calcium, you may expect less stiburn or less blossom end rot. Well, this is an example from tomato, so let's look then at blossom end rot. Sorry, I did not include that here, but you can expect then less blossom end rot. Now I would like to move on another aspect. If I talk to growers, quite often they want to control the balance between vegetative growth and generative growth. It's very important in, well, here's an example of tomato, but it's not only in tomato, it's in many crops, very important, vegetative growth, generative growth. Can we control that by nitrogen supply? Well, here we have an experiment with tomato. At the left-hand side, you see a treatment where we have excess nitrogen, so sufficient nitrogen. I would say that is the reference as most growers do grow plants. What you can see here is the fraction where the, of the weights of the different plant organs in terms of dry mass. So here with the excess nitrogen, 26% of all the mass of the plant was in the fruit. So this is a relatively young tomato crop of a few months old, 20% in the fruits. If you then look at the right-hand side of the figure, that is a treatment with a low nitrogen supply. Well, then you see a very interesting one. The fruits here are 35%. So 35%, definitely more than in the excess nitrogen, that's only 26%. Well, then you can also look, of course, at the fraction going to the leaves. Excess nitrogen, you have 30% leaves. While in the low nitrogen, you have 90% of the leaves. So here you see from excess nitrogen, you get a lot of vegetative growth, and at low nitrogen, the balance shifts more to generative. But of course, if you are a grower, it's not so much important what the ratio is, but it's a bit more important how many kilograms would you get. And well, then I have to disappoint you, because usually if you get these effects of the nitrogen supply, you do not, with low nitrogen, it's hardly ever you will get more kilograms. So the plant distributes it in a different way, but quite often also the total growth of the plant is a bit reduced. So it will be very difficult to get more fruits in this way. Occasionally, I've seen it in experiments, but usually you do not get more kilogram. Okay, so far about the nitrates. Now we would like to move on to the phosphates. Phosphates or PO4. Well, starting again, what are the major functions of phosphate in the plants? Well, first of all, phosphate is very important for the energy metabolism in the ATP or ADP. It plays a role in the cell membranes. It's in the DNA, in the genetic material. It's part of proteins. And maybe for some of you, it's also relevant to know that the phosphate in the seed is very important for the initial growth of the seedling. So there should be sufficient phosphate in the seed, and that will help a vigorous growth after germination. Well, the phosphate in the plant, similar as for nitrogen, it's mobile in the plant, so it can move from old parts to younger parts. Well, but not similarly as nitrogen, it's relatively low concentrations in the plant. And then, well, then there can be questions, can we get too much phosphorus in the plant? So if you have too much, it might be toxicity. Well, it's quite rare to have toxicity, so usually no toxicity occur, but it might be, and it might, for instance, induce iron or zinc deficiency. And here in this graph, I think this is the very typical example of what you can expect from a plant when there is not sufficient phosphorus. So the left-hand side, the tomato plant with low phosphorus, at the right-hand side with high phosphorus. But similar type of graph pictures could be shown for many crops. High phosphorus, you see green leaves, a big plant, low phosphorus, relatively a small plant, small leaves. But the most typical thing is that it looks a little bit red. So you have more anthocyanins in the plant, which gives it a red, purple color. Well, examples from some other crops, here chrysanthemum, very clear symptoms of low phosphorus, and the deficiency symptoms you see mainly in the lower leaves. Well, that's typical for an element like phosphorus, which is mobile in the plant. Or another example from a cucumber plant, so reduced growth, smaller leaves, And again, the major symptoms can be observed in the older leaves. Also, a very clear example, I think, from cyclamen at the right-hand side, high phosphorus. Well, I don't think it needs much explanation. At the left-hand side, not sufficient phosphorus, a very reduced growth of the plant. If you look at phosphorus, well, let's start then with the uptake of the phosphorus. But before we can look at the uptake, it's important how much is it available for the roots. And for phosphate, the pH in the rooting medium is very important. And phosphate can be in different forms of phosphate. At high pH, it is usually in the form of HPO4. It's a negative ion with a negative charge of 2, so it's 2 minus. So let's say the pH is about 8, then all of the phosphates is in the form of HPO4. If you go to a bit lower pH, you will see less HPO4. Well, what form is it then? Now go in the wrong direction. Yes, now we go again in the right direction. Now you see at the lower pH, the form of phosphate will be H2PO4. So that's the red line. So we'll hardly find any H2PO4 at the pH of 8, but at the pH of 5, all the phosphates will be in the form of H2PO4. So far we have seen two forms of phosphate, but there's also a third form. And that's when we go to even lower pH. And then you can see, so if you go to lower pH, then you can see the red line drop, so we get less H2PO4. And what appears then? That's the black line, and that indicates the H3PO4. Okay, so depending on the pH, you have a different form of phosphate. Well, the very low pH levels of, let's say, 1 or 2, well, that's very acid. So you will usually not find so low pH in your rooting medium. I also would not recommend to go that low. If you would be at a pH of 5, then...
The phone is ringing.
Sorry for that. At a pH of 5, most of the phosphate is in the form of the H2PO4. That's a form which is well soluble and can be easily taken up by the plant. But if you go then to the high pH, we have the HPO4, well, and then we may get into problems, because there we may get precipitation. So the HPO4, together with the calcium, might lead to precipitation. It might also form complexes with iron and aluminium. So the high pH should be prevented, because then we have a low availability, because we get the precipitation and therefore a low availability. These three phosphate forms are also called orthophosphates. And rather than orthophosphates, you might also think of polyphosphates. Well, what are polyphosphates? Poly, it's a Greek word meaning many. So we have many phosphates. It's in fact a very big molecule. It's in fact a chain of the phosphate molecules. The polyphosphate as such is a very that big that it cannot be taken up by the roots. But the nice thing is, at the root surface, it can be broken down in the phosphates. Well, and those phosphates can be taken up by the roots. Well, what is the most important of polyphosphates is that they are insensitive to pH. So if you have, So it does not respond to the pH, so it helps then that phosphates are available at all pH levels. And another aspect of polyphosphates is that it can prevent blocking of irrigation system. So when can you have most of the benefits out of polyphosphates? That's in particular when you have for long periods problems with high pH, or when you have a weak root system, or when you have often problems with blocking of the irrigation systems. In those cases, polyphosphates might be a good alternative. Let's now look at the plants. What is the response of phosphorus to the plants? And I also would like to come back a little bit to nitrogen, also to compare those two nutrients. So what do we see here on the graph? On the y-axis, we see the growth rate of the plant, and on the x-axis, we see the nutrient concentration in the plant. I will start with the red line, the nitrogen. So on the x-axis, if you start at a nitrogen concentration of 1, and these are here now in relative terms, so 1 means optimal concentration of nitrogen. If the concentration drops to lower values, then you see, well, soon you get a reduction in growth, and it goes more or less gradual. The lower the concentration in the plant, the lower the growth rate. And then you see a difference with the blue line, the phosphorus. Because phosphorus, it can drop from the optimal level to almost half the concentration without any effect on growth rate. But then, all of a sudden, the growth rate drops quite dramatically. So a different response to the concentration in the plant. And before I continue, I would like now to ask you one more question. So we have another poll. Yes, I think you can see it now. The question is, which plant process is most affected, or do you think is most affected, by a shortage of phosphorus? Is it the leaf photosynthesis, so the photosynthesis per unit leaf area? Or do you think, no, it's the leaf area expansion? Or do you think, no, the most important is the distribution of acetylates between the different plant organs? And I see, I'm looking if you are responding. Quite some people are responding at this moment, still some activity. I guess, well, I will wait a few seconds. Okay, now I will stop in 2 seconds to one. Yes, I stop here and I will show you the results. Oh, and this is quite interesting what we do see here. So it's a very mixed results. 23% of the people think it is the leaf photosynthesis. 29% think it's leaf area. And 47%, so half of the people think the most important is the distribution of the different among the different plant organs. Okay, well, very nice. Then from this I will show you some of the results. And first of all, I focus on photosynthesis and leaf area. You could say simply growth is a product of leaf photosynthesis and leaf area, where leaf photosynthesis is the photosynthesis per unit leaf area. If there are some people in the audience who are used to classical growth analysis, you might find some similarities here in this with RGR, relative growth rate, as a product of Na, net assimilation rate, and La, leaf area ratio. Okay, the lower part is not so important. Here I would like to focus on growth as a product of photosynthesis and leaf area. I have this graph, maybe a little bit of a complicated one, but I will try to explain what you see here. You see on the y-axis you will see the net photosynthesis of a leaf, and on the x-axis you see the growth rate. Here you see the growth rate, I indicated now with the cursor. If you are at the right-hand side of the graph, so here you have a high growth rate, and that is when there is a high phosphorus supply. So if you go in the curve, down the curve from right to left, a reduction in growth rate, because we reduced the phosphorus supply. And what do you see here? If you start here at the right-hand top side of the graph, a high growth rate is reduced to limited supply of phosphorus, but photosynthesis here more or less the same. Only when the supply has gone down quite a bit, only then photosynthesis drops. So I conclude from this graph, photosynthesis only drops at a severe limitation of phosphorus. Now we continue a little bit. Now we look at the lower graph, where you can find the leaf area. Similar type of graph, on the x-axis the growth rate. If we start at the right-hand side, that's where we start with the high phosphorus, where there was a high growth rate. We go to the left, a little bit of less phosphorus, and you see the curve immediately going down. So reduction in the leaf area. So what do we learn here? That if you go down in your phosphorus supply, the first thing to respond is the leaf area. You get smaller leaves. Because of smaller leaves, the plant can intercept less light. And if they intercept less light, they cannot use the light that efficient. There will be less growth. So what you see, at a mild limitation, it's mainly the leaf area. At a severe limitation, it's mainly photosynthesis. So I'm also not surprised that some of you thought it's photosynthesis, some others said leaf area, because it's hard to say it in general. But here I would say, mild limitation, leaf area, severe limitation, mainly a major effect of photosynthesis. But there's a third factor, and that's the distribution among the plant parts, in particular the distribution to the roots. And that you can see here on the y-axis, You see the fraction root mass. The fraction root mass, I mean the ratio of the root weight to the total plant weight. So if you see here 0.2 on the y-axis, it means 20% of all the plant mass is in the root and 80% is above ground to the shoot. Well, and then you can see if the phosphorus concentration, what you can find on the x-axis, if that goes down, the fraction to the roots goes up. So more roots, relatively more roots at low phosphorus supply. Well, that's of course not so surprising because, well, what does a plant do if there is not sufficient phosphate? He think, wow, I would like more phosphorus. How can I get more phosphorus? Okay, invest a little bit in roots. Maybe I can find some more phosphorus. And that is more or less a reason why you will find a higher fraction of roots at low phosphorus concentration. So to summarize this, in this effect, at mild limitation, we get less. Mild limitation of phosphorus, we get less leaf area. At a severe limitation, we get less photosynthesis. But if you consider the whole range from mild to severe limitation, going to a limitation, you get relatively more roots. So this holds for phosphorus. And now you may wonder, what about nitrogen? Well, we did do similar type of experiments with nitrogen. And I would say in these overall terms, it's more or less the same for nitrogen. And you can see that also here in this next graph. What you do see here is on the x-axis, the concentration of nitrogen in the plant in relative terms. So if it is one, that means the maximum concentration of nitrogen in the plant. On the y-axis, you see also relative terms, the rate or the growth rate. If we start at the green line and start from the right-hand side where it is one as in relative terms, as soon as the nitrogen concentration drops down from one to lower values, the growth in leaf area is reduced. Again, if you then look at photosynthesis, which is the blue line, you see the first drops in plant in nitrogen concentration in the plant, no effect on photosynthesis, only when there is a further decrease of the nitrogen. Well, and again, then for the distribution of assimilates to the roots, then look at the red line. The lower the concentration in the plant, the higher the fraction of assimilates partitioned to the roots. With phosphorus, we could also think of some other applications. And that you can see here, with many plants, in particular the potted plants, the consumers want compact plants, short plants. Can we do that by some phosphorus limitation? Well, the results you can see here. From the left-hand side, where is a high concentration of phosphorus supply, 0.5 millimolar per liter, and then we go to the right-hand side to 0.2, 0.1, or 0.01. Well, what you see here, the lower the phosphorus supply, the more compact the plant, the shorter they are. So I should say, yes, it is possible by phosphorus limitation, you can keep the plants more compact. However, I must say, if I look at these plants, I get also the feeling at a low supply, yeah, that are also very small plants, so the growth is reduced a lot. So in practical terms, it will be very difficult to keep the plants compact and not to have a too much reduction in growth. Now, some other effects of phosphates, which can be quite interesting, that is the effects on the calcium uptake. And I think also in the previous webinar, there was a question about this. So that's also why we included now this, this graph. What do we see here on the y-axis of the graph? You see the calcium concentration in the top part of the plant. And the top part, the plant here is also tomato. On the x-axis, you see at the left-hand side, the supply of low calcium, or on the right-hand side, the supply of high calcium. I want to say, don't want to say too much about cations. I would like to focus now on the phosphorus. So the blue bars, that is for when the supply is at a high, of phosphorus at a high rate of 2.5 millimole per liter. Or the red bars, that is for a medium supply, 1.25 millimolar. Or we can go down to a low phosphorus supply of only 0.75 millimolar. What do we see here? The green bars are relatively low. Low bars means low calcium concentration. So at low phosphorus, we don't get so much calcium uptake. The blue bars, they're the highest. So at high phosphorus supply, we do get a little bit of more calcium uptake. So this is probably the same phenomenon as I earlier showed about the chloride. phosphorus also can form an iron pair with calcium, facilitating the uptake. And so if there is more calcium uptake, you expect less problems with physiological disorders like Tyburn or blossom end rot. I should also make one remark to this graph. I indicated that these were at the lower side of the graph, that these data were from Vogt, but I have to correct that these are data from Kees de Kreij. And as I indicated, high phosphorus, you get more calcium uptake, and indeed we also found effects on the blossom end rot. So the high phosphorus, more calcium uptake, less problems with blossom end rot.
Leo.
Yeah.
Leo, we received a question from Jim from the United States, and he asked you, telling about calcium with phosphate, is this working together? Is it the same for magnesium?
That's a very good question, whether it also helps for magnesium. I must say at this moment, I don't really know the answer. I'm sorry for that.
Okay, no problem. We come back on it later via email.
Okay, then I continue with the last topic of my presentation, that's about sulfates. But before I continue here, I would like to ask you a question about sulfates. And my question is, do you consider sulfate as an important nutrient? Do you consider it as important? Yes, that's A. Or maybe you don't consider it very important. Then it's B, no. Or maybe you don't know. Well, that's click C. Okay, so please, I see quite some people responded already. A few more are coming in. So please make up your minds. Yes, a few more responding. I will wait 3 seconds. Oh no, maybe I should wait a little bit more because I see quite some activity in the polls. Wait a little bit more. What is the most important? Is it, how important is it? Yes or no? Okay, this should be enough. 3, 2, 1. Then I stop the poll. I will show you the result. So what do we see? 80% consider sulfate as an important nutrient. 14% of the audience doesn't think it is important. And a few didn't know what they should think. Okay, well, then we will see what are some results of sulfate. But before going into too much detail, I will first also indicate a little bit here some general remarks about phosphates or sulfur, sulfur indicated by the S. Well, the sulfur is taken up by plants as SO4. It's used in proteins. And unlike nitrogen or phosphorus, it's immobile in the plant. So it will not move. Once it's in an old leaf, it will stay there and will not go to younger leaves. If there is not sufficient sulfate in the plant, well, what can happen? The color will change. It will get pale green, or it might get gray, or leaves might get also a bit yellow. It is better to look also here at a graph of sulfate deficiency. Here, an example from sweet pepper at the left-hand side, a high supply rate of sulfur, and at the right-hand side, low supply rate. I think the example is quite clear what you can expect, that you get a growth reduction, a change in color. Well, with sulfur, you might also think besides growth on disease resistance. In many crops, sulfur vapor is used to control diseases, fungal diseases like mildew. Then the question is, does it also work like that? If you supply it to the roots, do you get less disease problems? Well, you can find in the literature that if there is really a shortage of sulfur, that you might have a less resistance to diseases. However, usually in the, well, at least in greenhouse horticulture, the more intensive horticulture, this situation usually does not occur. There is usually already sufficient sulfate in the roots that a further increase of sulfate will not lead to a decrease in to more resistance to diseases. Well, what does it do with growth? And what we found usually is that over a wide range, and that's what you can see here on the x-axis, so the sulfate concentration was varied from a very low concentration from 0.1 up to 20 millimolar, and at most concentrate, and then on the y-axis you see the total plant weight. In most cases, all the growth of all of the plants was similar. only when you go down as low here as in this experiment as to 0.1 millimolar, then we found a reduction in growth rate. And if you would go down even to lower concentration, well, then you get a very dramatic reduction in growth. But it only, so growth reduction only occurs at very low rates of supply, but otherwise, over a wide range, you will not find real effects of sulfate. Well, the same experiment, you could also look at the chlorophyll content, so that indicates how green the leaves are. And also here you see, at most concentrations, it was the same, except for when you go down as low as 0.1 millimolar of sulfate. Well, then I'm almost at the end of my presentation. I would like to just summarize a few conclusions. I started with nitrate and phosphate, and we've seen, well, some, quite often you can have some reduction in the supply, and usually it does not directly give any problem. But if you go down a little bit further, then you get a severe reduction in growth. And usually the first process responding is that you get smaller leaf area, and a smaller leaf area, you could also say less vegetative growth, but a smaller leaf area usually means less interception of light, and if the plant cannot intercept that much light, you get a reduction in growth. With chloride and phosphate, well, it might be some interesting effect that it gives some slight enhancement of the calcium uptake. If we go to the phosphates, it's very important to consider the availability, which is very much dependent on the pH. So in particular pH around 5, then usually the pH is quite soluble in the solution. So that's good pH. But a too high pH, you get you have a large chance of precipitation. Well, and then finally, I concluded about the sulfate, that within a wide range, there are not real effects on the growth. Only if you go very low, then the growth is reduced. And then I'm at the end of my presentation, and there is time for questions.
Okay, Leo, thank you very much for your presentation. A lot of questions were answered by our moderating team. I see that almost 100 questions were asked during the seminar, so that's very good. Let's see what I can see. Yeah, there is a question from a gentleman from Griekenland, from Greece, AgroModern. And he's asking for Lola Rosso lettuce. Can you change the color? Because I want the red color on the Lola Rosso. Can I change it by changing pH?
By changing pH, I'm not sure. I don't think there is a direct effect of the pH on the color itself, but the pH will change the availability of some nutrients. I think the question was by low pH or, well, by just by changing,
yeah, changing the pH.
Yeah. If you go up to very high pH, you might get problems with phosphate availability. That definitely will make the plants more red, but I'm not sure if that is what you like, because they will get more red, but you also will get a growth reduction. There might also be some effects on micronutrients, but if you go to the micronutrients, I would like to refer to the next webinar, which where we will focus on micronutrients.
Okay, before I go further, I want to start. Want to ask you to click here to join our next webinar. But I also have another question for you, Leo. And this question is there a maximum amount of phosphate that you can give to the plants?
If there is a max, well, what you can give, well, you can give as much as you want. Usually, there is not really a toxicity of too much phosphate. So you will not really get problems in most cases. That's also what I indicated. So toxicity is rare. It might happen, but usually only at very high. But then you are really going at very high levels. More of a problem is if you have a high phosphorus supply that you might get precipitation. So anyhow, in the nutrient solution, the concentration will not go up that high.
Okay. Well, okay, I see that at this moment, more than 100 questions were answered by our moderating team. There are no questions sent to the studio anymore. So I want to thank you for joining this webinar. The moderators are, after the webinar, half an hour after the webinar, available for answering your questions. So please keep online if you ask a question. And it's also possible that if you cannot answer the question right now because it's too complicated, we're going to send you an email with the answer on your questions. So looking forward to see you on the next webinar, and thank you for joining this webinar. Thank you, Leo, and see you next time.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.